These three common learning myths are preventing you from learning effectively and scoring well on your exams. And in this video, we're busting them with hard scientific data. By the end, you will know exactly what you need to do in order to score higher and remember longer. In fact, I combed through dozens of research studies with the help of Consensus, the sponsor of this video, to find the truth about how we learn and remember information long term. I'm going to tell you exactly what to do so you can supercharge your learning according to cognitive science. So let's jump to the whiteboard and get started. Our first myth is that studying helps you remember. Now, I know what you're thinking. Studying, that's the bread and butter of how we learn things. But it turns out that studying, how we normally think of it, is actually pretty ineffective when it comes to remembering things long-term. Let's take a look at what I mean by that. When we think of learning information, we think of taking some information from, let's say, a book or slides or wherever it is. We've got some information source and we're trying to get that into our brain. And so we think about it like this. Information's going from that source into our brain. And so we'll do things like this. We may reread our notes. We may watch more videos. I will never discourage you from watching more of my videos on repeat, but it might not be the most effective thing for your learning. And we'll do things like highlighting and rewriting. I've known students who will take their notes that they took in class and they'll rewrite those notes out a second or third time, just try to get the information into their brain. But it turns out it's really not about information going into our brain, it's about information coming out of our brain. And the problem with these three strategies are that they're very passive. And passive learning is ineffective learning. Now, don't take my word for it. Let's look at what some actual science research studies have to say about this. So the first one I want to look at is a study by Karpicki and Roediger. So what they did is they gave every participant some word pairs in Swahili and English. So for example, mashua means boat. They gave them intervals where they would study those word pairs, and then they would test them on those word pairs. And then they would have more time to study, and then they would test them again, and then there would be more time to study, and then they would test them again. They did that over the course of one day, and then 1 week later, they came back in, and they tested them again to see how many of those words they remembered. Now, on that initial day of studying, every time they tested them, the participants would get some number of those words correct, like the ones that I've grayed out on the screen here. What they changed up between the control group and the experimental groups, though, is whether or not the participants would see those words that they got correct again later that day whenever they studied or tested on these words a second time. And what the researchers were looking for is whether or not studying mattered or whether testing mattered when it came to actually remembering the information a week later. So they would test on the information, they get some words right, and then they would test again and they get some more words right, and they'd repeat that process for the rest of that day. And here's what the researchers actually found. It turns out that repeated studying after learning, after getting that word right once, repeated studying had no effect on delayed recall. In other words, if they kept studying that word over and over again the rest of the day, it did not help them remember that word a week later. However, repeated testing produced a large positive effect. In other words, if they kept getting tested on that word after they'd gotten it right once, that led to them actually remembering that word a week later. Here's what the actual data from the study shows. You'll see four groups here. This first group, they, after they got the word right, they still studied the word in subsequent study sessions and tested on it in subsequent study sessions that day. Another group, they would only get tested on that word, but they wouldn't keep restudying those words that they'd gotten right. In this group, they would study the words that they got right, but they wouldn't be tested on them again. And in this final group, they would neither study nor retest on the words once they'd gotten them right. But look at the trend here. The thing that really matters is whether or not they were tested on those words after getting them right once. If they were tested on the words after they'd gotten them right, they scored about 80% a week later. And you can see in that third study, the ones that studied those words, that didn't help them remember the stuff like at all. They still scored about 30%, which is not great. So this is huge. And if you don't believe me, neither did the students. It turns out that the students' predictions of how they would perform a week later, the ones that had been retested on it and actually learned the information really well, they didn't think they would remember it any better than the students who actually only scored 35% or so a week later. So the truth here for our myth that studying helps you remember is that testing helps you remember. And that doesn't mean you need to take more tests on the subject, but that you need to test yourself, try to actively recall that information from memory, and that's going to serve you a lot better than trying just to like reread the information and cram it into your brain. It's about remembering it, bringing it out of your brain. And that's why, for example, in pretty much all of my YouTube videos, I have a blank diagram like this at the end of it so that you have a chance to try to remember that information. It's so that you can really learn it better and remember it not just today, but a week later. Now, everything in this video is based off of science, and I actually got some help in finding all these articles and sort of probing them to find out the information inside them, and that's from our sponsor of this video, Consensus. So check this out. I go to Consensus and I ask it a question such as, does testing yourself improve your long-term memory? Consensus then combs through millions of research papers to find an answer to my question, which in this case is, yes, testing yourself, retrieval practice, significantly improves long-term memory compared to simply restudying material. It turns out there's 20 studies, according to the Consensus meter here, that back that up. See, I told you I wasn't making this up. It's all about testing yourself. If I keep going, it's going to give me a list of tons of studies that back up the claim that are very relevant to the question that I'm trying to answer. And if I click on that study, I can get more information about it, such as a PDF of the study. I can quickly see the abstract for the study, and then I can see a snapshot, which will give me metadata on the study, like who did they actually study? How long was the study for? That's super helpful in telling me if I want to go all the way in and actually read the study. If I click on details though, it takes me here and I can ask questions about the paper. For example, I could say, give me a summary of the results. And then it'll give me a quick summary of the paper so I can decide if I want to read further into it. Do you know how long this video would have taken if I was just searching around on Google for this information? There's also a deep search mode that gives comprehensive topic coverage and visual summaries. I have a friend who researches how to use mRNA for early Alzheimer's detection, so I ran a deep search on that topic. And it turns out, according to the Consensus meter, that results are promising, but more research needs to be done, which is why he's doing more research. So if you read research papers, Consensus can save you a ton of time, just like it saved me in making this video. You can start with Consensus free or unlock 1 month of Pro version free using my link, get.consensus.app/siebertscience. Pro supercharges your research with more deep searches and pro analyses. All right, now on to myth number two, which is gonna blow your mind even more, and that's that forgetting means that you failed. It turns out forgetting doesn't mean you failed. Everybody forgets information. It's part of the natural learning process. Now, to better understand that, we need to look at something called the Ebbinghaus forgetting curve. This graph was first created by German psychologist Hermann Ebbinghaus in 1885, so it's not the most cutting edge research per se, but it still stands true today. So on our vertical axis over here, we have memory, how much of the information have we remembered, and then on the horizontal axis, we're looking at how much time has passed. And it turns out the graph for information that we learn looks something like this. Whatever we learn, 100% of that we have in that moment, and then immediately that starts falling off. We start forgetting stuff immediately. And then a day later, we might only remember 40% of the stuff that we learned. And then a day later, it's gonna go down, and it's gonna go down and down over time. And so this is very bad news for us. But luckily, there's something we can do in order to sort of hack this forgetting curve and to remember the information that we need to know months or years later. Let's take a look at a 2015 study from Hopkins and Lyle where they compared spaced retrieval to retention. Spaced retrieval is waiting some amount of time and then trying to re-remember the information, kind of like we talked about in the first myth here. How did that affect retention for mathematics knowledge? And they studied engineering students in a pre-calculus class. What they did in the control group is every week they had a quiz, and on that quiz they would give them some quiz questions on the topic they had learned that week. So if they had learned topic three that week, they would get quiz questions on topic three. But in the experimental group with the same teacher and same everything else, the only difference is instead of giving them the quizzes that were only on that topic, they would give them a quiz that had a question maybe on that week's topic, but also on topics from previous quizzes. So in week three, they'd have a topic three question, a topic two, and then maybe a topic one question as well, all on the same quiz. So anytime they learned a topic, they would test on it that week, but they would also test on it or quiz on it a week later and maybe a couple weeks later. They would have multiple weeks where they would have quiz questions on that topic, not only the week that they learned it. In other words, they were spacing their quizzing of that topic out over multiple weeks, not just all at once. So let's take a look at what they actually learned from the study. Here was their pre-calculus final exam data. And this control group right here, that's the ones who were just taking a quiz each week over that week's information. And you can see they had an average of around 62 or 63%. And then in the experimental group, where they had quizzes that covered multiple topics, we see these scores. Now on this graph, you'll see the masked bar and the spaced bar. So in this experimental group, they gave them some topics where their quizzing was masked. In other words, they only got the questions for that week's topic on that week. And they had other topics in that experimental group where they spaced out those topics over time, like I described for the experimental group. So it turns out by spacing out some of the quizzing on some of the topics, it actually helped even with the topics that weren't spaced out. Now, if that got confusing at all, the main takeaway is this. We shouldn't just test ourselves on that day for the topic. We need to spread out our testing over time. We'll talk about why that is in just a moment. Now, what they did in the study, they not only stopped there, they tracked these same students into their next class. So not pre-calculus, but calculus one. And here's what they found. They didn't keep doing this whole quizzing thing. They just compared, okay, would they remember that information so well that they would do even better on their actual calculus one exams? Because the pre-calculus topics were so foundational to their learning of calculus. And it turns out it did have a noticeable impact. You can see here the white bar is for the experimental group that had their quiz questions spaced out over time. They actually scored higher on the final exam, even in calculus one. So the learning that they did by spreading out the quiz questions in pre-calculus had an effect even in their calculus class. So it really stuck with them. Very powerful tool. All right, so let's go back to this Ebbinghaus forgetting curve. How can we hack this in order to remember and not forget most of the stuff that we learned? The idea here is that we have to interrupt our forgetting. So maybe you learned some information. After a day, you've forgotten some of it. And so you're gonna do another recall of that information. You're gonna try to remember all that information from memory, not by rereading your notes, but just by sort of quizzing yourself on it. Can you remember all that information? And then you're gonna learn most of that again, and you're gonna start to forget it again. Notice the forgetting curve continues on, but you're gonna wait another day, do another recall of that information, and notice what happens every time you wait a day or two and do another recall. The amount that you forget actually decreases. And by the time you've done this three or four times on a topic, 80, 90% of that information or more is gonna stick with you long term. And that's why cramming doesn't work. Cramming can help you maybe if your test is tomorrow, but if you wanna get a bunch of information in your brain and then forget it and never use it again, cramming can work. But if you wanna learn information so that it sticks with you, so you can use it on your final exam or use it in your job and your career or just know that information, then spaced recall like this is gonna be your ticket. So like we said, forgetting does not mean you failed. The truth is that we must interrupt our forgetting curve by doing spaced retrieval of the information that we learned once, wait a day, retrieve that information again, wait another day or two, retrieve that information again until it sticks with us. All right, two myths down, let's take a look at our third myth. Our third myth is that memorization equals rote repetition. Now, this is one that I'm pretty passionate about as an anatomy and physiology teacher. And the reason for that is I get this question all the time. Isn't anatomy mostly rote memorization? And early on in my teaching career, I kind of believed it, but it didn't ever sit right with me. We weren't just memorizing facts. We were learning how systems work together and learning how the different parts of the body work together for us to function. But on my quizzes, it was a lot of just memorizing things. So what I wanted to look at is an actual study where they studied anatomy students. And does it turn out that just rote repetition of facts is the best way to remember things or not? So in this study by Nikawara, they looked at concept mapping, which is a way of representing ideas on a page and connecting the ideas together. And how did that affect students' memorization of anatomy? So we're looking at memorizing, but could something like concept mapping, where we're connecting ideas, actually help our memory even better? So what they did in this study is they looked at first year medical students. In the control group, they would give them some information that they had to memorize. In the experimental group, they would have the same information, but instead of just trying to memorize that information as presented, they would teach them how to do a concept map, which would look something sort of like this, where they've taken these ideas, these terms, these structures, whatever they were studying, and instead of just remembering them from a list or from one diagram, they would create concept maps where they're connecting the ideas together and thinking about how the different structures relate to each other. And in fact, I've started doing this kind of thing in a lot of my videos. For example, in my video on the coronary arteries, after I had done the diagram of the coronary arteries, I did kind of a little flow chart like this, which is really a concept map showing how the different arteries connect together in this sort of web that they form. And in another video where we were learning the organelles of the cell, instead of just teaching students, here's what each organelle does as their separate standalone things, I created a concept map throughout that video where I was connecting all of these different organelles together and explaining the process of protein synthesis. So we can see how they all work together in this kind of flow chart right here. Now that cell video is actually my number one performing video at the moment, and it's not because I explained what each one does so well, but it's because I included a concept map like this so people could start connecting the ideas together of these different structures and what they actually do. So let's go back to the study and see what do they actually find in their results. So the students who did the concept mapping, the experimental group, compared to the students who just learned in sort of a normal way, like kind of rote memorization style, those students who did the concept maps performed significantly better than the students who didn't. And the researchers found that this was especially effective, not just when they took a test like a few days later, but months down the road they tested those students again, and that's where the concept map students performed way better than the rest of the group. So by connecting ideas together, we can remember things more long-term than we can otherwise. So the truth here is not that memorization equals rote repetition, but that we can memorize more by making connections. Now, when we learn new ideas, we can connect them to each other. We can connect those ideas to things that we already know. If it's anatomical structures, we can make silly connections based on the name and things that they look like. But the idea here is that we have a web of information in our brain and we're connecting all kinds of ideas together. Now, I have one more myth for you. This is a bonus myth. The bonus myth is that you are a visual learner. And this is maybe the most controversial myth that I have in the video because this really speaks to some people's identity. And to say that that's a myth, don't click away. Let me explain what's really going on here. So the fact that people claim to be a visual learner or an auditory learner or a kinesthetic learner, it's a myth. We don't have these learning styles that if we learn according to our preferred learning style, we're gonna learn better. A common framework that people share about this is VARC, which stands for visual, auditory, reading and writing, and kinesthetic. It turns out that that is a myth. A better way to think about it is this, using something called dual coding. Dual coding is a research-based idea that says that we're gonna learn information better if we don't just learn it in one sort of format or learning style, but that we see it in multiple. So for example, you're gonna learn information better if you see it both visually and verbal. The verbal could be like auditory or it could be reading words on a page. It doesn't matter if you think of yourself as a visual or an auditory learner, you're gonna learn better if you engage with the information in multiple formats. Here's an example from one of my own videos. In this case, it's on the sliding filament model. And if you see in this diagram, there's visual information. You see all the diagrams in there. There's also verbal information. There's words written out explaining what happens in each step. And in the video, of course, I'm explaining it audibly, so there's audible information there. And when I do this particular process, I have students actually like move their arms and pretend like they're grabbing the actin and then pulling for the power stroke and all of that. So we get some kinesthetic in there as well. So it really turns out we're all visual learners, we're all auditory learners, we're all kinesthetic learners. The more senses and formats we can engage with, the better we're gonna understand the information that we're learning. So the truth here that corresponds to this myth is that you learn best when you use multiple formats in your learning. All right, we covered a lot of information in this video. Just to do a quick recap here, we learned that testing helps you remember, so retest yourself on information that we're learning. We learned that we must interrupt the forgetting curve. So forgetting's normal, but you need to space out your retrieval or space out your testing in order to interrupt that forgetting curve and remember more. We learned that we can memorize more by making connections, not just by rote memorizing things from a list or from a diagram, but connect the ideas together. And then we found that we learn best when we use multiple formats. So hopefully all that information helps you learn better and more effectively so you can do better on your exams and whatever you need to learn information for. Now, if in your learning, as part of your job or your studies, you read research articles, then consensus is the way to go. So if you wanna try out consensus, go to get.consensus.app/siebertscience so you can get access to the best in-depth analysis of journal articles out there. Special thanks to my supporters on Patreon and YouTube channel members. Thank you all for supporting the channel. And if you wanna improve your learning, if you wanna score better on exams, remember information longer, achieve your dream of becoming a nurse, doctor, EMT, whatever your dreams are, then check out my Memory Lab program where I teach you the best cognitive science and teach you the study strategies that can help you get the grades that you want and remember the information better long-term. And if you're studying anatomy and physiology specifically, I have study cards and comprehensive guides. You can find those in my online store. Links in the description for all of these things. And if you watch to the end, you might like this video about how memory works. It really informs a lot of the information that I talked about in this video. Thanks for watching, good luck learning, and thanks for being here.